Well, first and foremost, thank you for coming out. Wonderful to be here. Beautiful night on our wonderful campus. I'm Mark Spurs. I'm actually the manager of the Industry Connect team here at the Curtin Business School. So it's wonderful to be here. I was just reflecting with a few of my gentlemen from RISC about sitting in their office. What, 9 months ago, I was thinking about the fact that how things have moved so quickly with the change of government already. The West Coast Eagles school is devastated like myself. A lot of things quickly change, and it's interesting that this evening we talk about management of uncertainty. It proves that even a short space of time when we brought up this particular series, that there has been a lot of change. So I've got to do all of the important things, like tell you that if there is any form of emergency or a fire or anything like that, or Kim Kardashian walks in the door and need to get out, please proceed out through the exits there and to the left of me here. I would also, of course, like to acknowledge that we, the traditional owners of the land which we meet this evening, the Noongar people of Western Australia, and pay respect to their elders, past and present. So, the usual housekeeping, folks. If you'd just like to refer to your phone and either turn it off or mute it, that would be fantastic. I've already touched on the scenario where Kardashian walks in and leaves, that's fine. Tonight is the third and final event of our RISC Conversation Series, which was launched this year, and I've talked about that. Our key speaker this evening, and I'm very lucky to have him, is Simon Whitaker from RISC Advisor. Simon has a background in petroleum engineering, including reservoir production engineering, well evaluation, and varied operational experience. He's more than 30 years in industry. His more than 30 years industry career was spent working for companies such as Santos, BP, Apple X, and Mobil in Australia, Europe, North Africa, and Southeast Asia. Simon has spent the second part of his career in consulting. During this time, he reviewed hundreds of upstream assets, leading him and his colleagues at RISC to wonder why field development and project outcomes often so different to those envisioned at the time the project was approved. To elaborate on this and discuss effective management of uncertainty, risk, and improved performance, please welcome our special guest, Simon Whitaker. Welcome, Simon.
Thank you. Thank you. I don't think I've been described as a special guest before. And I'm afraid I did live up to the title on the way here, not being very good at management of uncertainty. Managed to take the wrong turn in coming down the freeway and had a bit of a detour. But fortunately, I was with our unflappable Scottish HR manager, and she got us here. But I didn't live up to my promise to our CEO that I'd be here by 5:30. But anyway, I was here on time. That's the main thing. Now, I've given quite a few industry talks over the years. When you get to my age, they sort of mount up, but they're usually in convention centres and hotels. I don't think I've spoken in the university environment since I was at uni, which was a very long time ago. But I think it's quite fitting that this is the venue for this talk, because, as you'll find out, it's a very general talk. It's not particularly technical, although the examples I give are technical. And there's no really real answers to the challenges that the examples I put up show. One of the ways to address the problems I'm going to canvass is education and training. So this is a very appropriate venue for this talk. So before I get going, I'll just tell you a little bit more about myself. I got a one-way ticket when I left uni from the UK out to Australia. Basically fell in love with the place, worked in the Cooper Basin for Santos for 4 years. Then I went back, worked in London, in the North Sea, in Egypt and in Brunei, and then came back to Perth in the early 90s, and nothing would get me to move from there. I joined RISC in 1998 and now head up what we call the Development Engineering Function. Essentially, we have in RISC, we're organized pretty much like an oil company. We have geoscientists who essentially define the static volumes in an oil field or a gas field. We have reservoir engineers who assess the dynamic performance of the reservoir, look at things like recovery factors, production forecasts, how many wells and what type of wells you need to exploit the resource. Then we have the development engineers, which is my group. We're essentially the interface between the subsurface guys and the commercial group. So we will look at things like wells and completions, facilities, operations, project management, HSE. And then the tail end, Charlie, the people who are left at 5 o'clock on a Friday to do the valuation are the commercial guys. And one of those is here, Simon Dowse, so he'll be able to empathise with that comment. So that just sort of tells you where development engineering fits into the way RISC is structured. And also, an explanation for a lot of the examples I give are project related, but we also do touch on the subsurface as well. So that's just by way of background. Now, all I've got to do is find the pointer. Right, so headlines. In this case, the headlines are fairly true. I'm sure we've all heard about the big projects that are going on at the moment, and a lot of them are going over budget and away behind schedule. I guess the granddaddy of them all, as the Americans might say, is the Gorgon project, about 20 or so subsea wells, 100K subsea tieback to Barrow Island. It's going to be three LNG trains being built on the island, which just happens to be a nature reserve, and it's not going very well. The original project budget was $37 billion. That was when the project was approved in 2009. The latest official number is $54 billion, almost a 50% increase. When the project was approved in 2009, it was due to be on stream in 2014. They'll be lucky to be producing in 2016. So not a good news story, and unfortunately, that's not the only one. There's another mega project underway at the moment, a little bit behind Gorgon, called the Ichthys project in the Browse Basin. That was $34 billion at sanction just about a month ago. There was a 10% increase announced, and I'm afraid that's just the beginning of the bad news for these projects. So you could argue they are massive projects. I think Gorgon is the biggest private enterprise project ever undertaken in Australia. But equally, the proponents are the international oil companies with literally 100 years of experience in these things. So there's something we're not doing very well, and I'm going to elaborate on that a little bit more. So those were some sort of headlines. Right, what about some quotations? Every one of our 10 most important projects failed to generate the desired return. A large independent. The actual performance of our key assets wasn't even within the P1 to P99 range. So just a little bit of terminology here for those not familiar with it. P1 basically is at the very extreme. If it's assessed properly, there's only 1% chance you'd be below the P1 outcome. And again, there's only 1% chance you'd be above the P99. So really, if you've got your ranges right, which is something we'll talk about a bit later, you should be coming within that range. Using the same terminology again, well, if you've understood that, you'll realise why this next quote, it doesn't really make a lot of sense. The CEO says, I want to guarantee you won't be over the P50. Of course, that's not possible. You can guarantee you won't be over the P100. So if you're dealing with a CEO like that, that's probably one of the reasons why you've got problems. And this next one also sounds somewhat incongruous, but I can sympathise with it. What I need is an exact list of specific unknown problems. Now, of course, you can't do that, but I think unknown unknowns, as Rumsfeld liked to call, are something that we do need to somehow take account of when we're planning our projects. And it's, again, something I don't think we're doing. And I'll show an example of that shortly. Okay, so we've had headlines, we've had anecdotes, here's some facts. One of my team, unfortunately Joe isn't here today, he's in London, research, so this is all from public domain information. a number of projects. Obviously, I won't talk about all of them, but just to give you a feel for the spread of these projects, they're all oil and gas projects, a number of LNG projects, but here we have the Bayu-Undan project, which is essentially an LNG plant processing gas in Darwin that's being produced in the Timor Sea. That was in the early 2000s, before we saw the big increase in oil price and also in costs. That actually came in under budget. GLNG, that's one of the LNG projects in Queensland that's just come on stream very recently. Pluto, the Woodside project, sort of good news story now, but it did go about 30% over budget. Gorgon is actually higher than that now. Gatagas in the Middle East, Pohokuris, New Zealand. Sakhalin, Russia, Kashagan, Kazakhstan, Kores Island, Qatar, Pearls in Qatar. So this isn't an Australian problem. It's quite often sort of union and the mining boom, which of course is now over, talked about. These problems are not confined to Australia, and they're not to the oil and the gas industry, but that's the only thing I know about. Now, I mentioned unknown unknowns. Look at the skew on this distribution. So the median is a 36% overrun, but because of this skew here, the mean's actually 72%. And I think a lot of that skew in the distribution is down to so-called black swan events, or low probability, high consequence events, which actually aren't all that low probability. Just one example of that is Pluto on the northwest shelf here. That project was essentially complete when it was discovered that the flare tower wasn't cyclone-proof. Hard to believe that, you know, world-class EPC contractors and a very experienced operator like Woodside, something like that would happen, but it did. I think that goes into the black swan category. What have we got next? So there's a couple of busy slides here. I won't dwell on them too much, but this, we've been talking about costs until now. Here's schedule. Here's just some sort of randomly selected projects, all behind schedule. The overrun there was only 10 months or 23%. That's pretty good compared to some of those projects I mentioned at the beginning. That's from the final investment decision, i.e. when the go button is hit to proceed with the project to when it actually starts up. This next one, sorry, it's a bit of a messy slide as well, but this just shows the very important period when the key decisions are made leading up to FID. And this also shows that most companies didn't meet their FID targets. But personally, I'm a lot more relaxed about that. There's a well-known sort of slide in the industry, which I haven't shown today, but really you've add value to your project at this stage. Right? Once you hit FID, the train starts moving out of the station and there's little you can do to control it. It's front-end planning, front-end loading sometimes it's called, development planning, which is really where you make your key decisions and where you derive the most value from your project. Okay, I've given various anecdotes and a bit of research we've done. This is now an industry-wide study done in sort of two parts by a well-known consulting firm called IPA. First one in 2003. One in eight or 12.5% of projects could be classified as a disaster, where a disaster is defined as a project where the costs are overrun by 40%, the schedule slips by 40%, and most importantly, the first initial production is less than 50% of plan. That's the biggest value driver for those, the initial production. So these are for sort of decent-sized projects, but not mega projects. The average capex for those was 670 million. And that was in 2003, as I say, before we had all this sort of cost inflation that the industry has experienced as a result of the increased oil price. A sort of adjunct of that study was done in 2012. This is now focusing on mega projects, so it's not a like-for-like comparison, but this is truly startling. Only 22% of those projects were successful. Of the other 78%, an average of 30% cost overrun, this number's beginning to look quite familiar, 33% schedule slippage, and 64% didn't reach the production targets. Remember, that's the value driver. So we've got a problem. As I said, I'm mainly giving my examples about the surface, the sort of tangible things we can see. subsurface is arguably more important. Certainly my subsurface colleagues would argue that. So this shows graphically that sort of P90 to P10 distribution I was talking about. This is an actual gas field that we worked on as an expert witness assignment. However, I hasten to add, we didn't come up with either of these two distributions. So in an expert witness assignment, you'll get one expert acting for one side and one for the other. So they were both asked to come up with their range of gas in place for this field. And as we've discussed, your range should be broad enough to cover virtually all eventualities. Look at this. The P90 to P10 didn't even overlap. And this is two well-acknowledged industry companies, consultancies. So they're not managing uncertainty very well. So it applies both in the surface and the subsurface. Right, so what does this mean in terms of value? That's really what counts. As you can imagine, it's not good. A lot of red ink here. So this is showing the NPV of a project 2 years after the project started up compared to what the expected NPV was at startup. And you can see the green, only about 30% of these projects, the NPV was actually higher. A reasonable number, sort of 15 to 25%, were sort of close to expectation, but unfortunately 70% would be below what was expected at FID. So on average, a 41% erosion in value. I mean, that's the difference between making money and losing money. And this study was done in 2014, so again, before the impact of the oil price decline that we're now experiencing. So you can't blame it on the oil price. Okay, that's sort of the bad news. I hope I've communicated the fact that we're doing something wrong. Right, why are we getting our estimates so wrong? This is really focusing on the cost side of things. We should be okay at equipment costs, materials costs, labour costs and transportation costs. We can get quotations for those. They typically make up sort of 30 to 50% of a project cost. Okay, you do get variations and they can be significant, but I don't think it's really where the source of the problem is. Perhaps not counting IR issues, which can be quite material. So there's other factors at play here. Confusing accuracy with confidence as you get more and more information. I guess the thicker the report, maybe the more confidence you have in it. Believing sophistication reduces risk. If we see a Gantt chart with millions of bars on it and lots of interconnecting arrows, we tend to believe it. It's very easy to underestimate the time to do things, which of course relates to costs, because you always have a project management team sitting there and they're needed however long the project takes. So costs are very closely related to schedule. Scope changes, one of the projects I talked about earlier, essentially is in the position it's in because of scope changes. The sufficient front-end engineering wasn't done in that time up to FID. It's led to major design changes as a result of detailed design, which has added a lot of weight to the top sides, which in the case of a floating structure, you then need to... it has stability and weight issues for the actual the hull supporting the top sides that's leading to big problems. Ignoring or underappreciating dependencies and interdependencies. It's easy for me to say it. It's not an easy thing to do, but I think it is underappreciated. Poor risk management in terms of contingency plans and not having appropriate contractual protection. Basically, it comes down to poor project management. Usually when you hear of announcements of budget overruns, the weather is quoted, exchange rates, industrial relations. No doubt these roles have an influence, but I really think a lot of it is poor project management. Now, why are we poor at this? We've sort of changed tack a little bit now in the presentation. It's actually due to cognitive bias. Before I get to talk about that, I just want to talk about a seminal industry paper written by a very famous guy called Ed Capon in 1976. He worked for ARCO at the time. So what he did is he went around a bunch of meetings like this. They were actually Society of Petroleum Engineers meetings in the States, literally dozens of meetings, so hundreds if not thousands of people were given a questionnaire. They were asked 10 questions, which they weren't expected to know the answer, things such as how far is it from San Francisco to Hong Kong? When was the first monastery in Florida settled by European monks? So they weren't expected to know the answer. They were just required to give a range sufficiently broad that the respondents were 90% confident that their answer, that the actual answer, would lie within that range. So they're asked 10 questions, asked to give a P10 to P90, five to 95% range. So in other words, they should only get one of those 10 wrong if they got their ranges right. Consistently, in meeting after meeting, six to eight answers wrong. And if they'd got the range right, it would have been one. So this shows that essentially we're very bad at dealing with uncertainty. The less we know about something, ironically, the closer the range we tend to put on it. If we really understand the problem, we appreciate the uncertainties, and we put an appropriate range on it. In our consulting advice, probably the most common feedback we give our clients is you haven't recognised uncertainty sufficiently. It's not always an easy message to give, and you could argue it's easy for us as consultants, third parties, to sit back and say, you know, give a wider range, but people trying to get their projects through, their management don't want to hear that, and so they get influenced into giving more certainty than is warranted, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. So, Capon said, is there some deep underlying phenomenon that prevents our doing better? And there is. And the reason is heuristics and biases. So heuristics is essentially the way our brains are wired. There's been a lot of research done on this, and a theory is that essentially the way we process information is from when we earned our living in a very different way. We were hunter-gatherers, and we processed information intuitively. We had to make snap decisions. We didn't have the sort of cognizant processes that we now mainly use to earn a living. So this is not some wild theory. This is the way our brains are wired. We are subject to these heuristics, and therefore it introduces biases into our thinking. I'll give you a couple of examples. You've got a lily pad in the middle of a pond, and each day the area of the lily pads doubles. So after 48 days, it's covered the whole pond. How many days for it to cover half the pond?
One day.
One less, 47, very good. But because it doubles every time. But a lot of people would be drawn initially to saying 24. Another one, a bat and ball adds up to, it costs $1.10. The bat costs $1 more than the ball. How much does the bat and ball cost? You're probably tempted to say $1.10, but that's not right. It's $1.05. So just simple examples of the way our brains work. And as I say, there's not some weird theory I've come up with. You're going to see the names Kahneman and Tversky come up on the screen for a number of slides. Daniel Kahneman was awarded the Nobel Prize for his work in the way we process information. And so it's very well researched, quite well understood, but not by our industry. I think sort of marketing and finance industries are a lot more onto this sort of flawed thinking than we are. So I'm now going to just quickly go through a few cognitive biases. There's over 100, and I'm certainly not going to talk about those. I'm just going to talk about a few interesting ones. There's decision-making biases, which essentially affect the way we make decisions. Probability belief biases, we distort our thinking just based on the way our beliefs. Social biases, very significant. I'll give an example of that socially, but we are distorted by people around us. and memory bias. It's just the way you're obviously going to be more influenced by things you can readily recall than by things you either can't remember or didn't ever know about. So this just shows some of the things I'm now going to address. First one is probably my favourite one, because it's easiest to explain, is experts. So heavier than their flying machines are impossible. Who said that? No less a person than the renowned physicist, Lord Kelvin, the Kelvin temperature named after him, president of the Royal Society. Within 10 years, of course, the Wright brothers were flying. This one's quite well known. There's a worldwide market for about 5 computers. Chairman of IBM in 1943. I think we all have 5 computers now, apart from me, because I lost my mobile phone last week. So, beware of experts. Right, this is a good one. This is now moved on to the way information is presented, but also overlaps with the expert example. So this is a real life example actually done by a guy called Professor Stephen Begg. He's a geologist by background, or a geophysicist in fact, professor now at the University of Adelaide. And he's one of the leading people in bringing this sort of research by the likes of Kahneman and Tversky into our industry. It's really him I've got to thank for my interest and our interest at RISC in this subject. So he did a little study. He had 4 groups of people here: third year petroleum engineering undergrads, fourth year undergrads who had had some training in decision making, master's conversion course, and practicing petroleum engineers with 10 years experience. So they were asked to give an estimate for how long it takes to drill a well. But the two groups were given the information presented or packed in different ways. So one group, the red group, were told, given information about the drilling time, the tripping time, and the rigging time, but then the downtime, the problem time, was just put in one category. Whereas the other group, the blue group, the all associated problems was unpacked into 6 different categories, which you can see there: mud conditioning, well control, fishing, weather, rig repairs and logistics. So same information but presented in different ways. And this is what they came up in terms of their time estimate to drill the well. So there's a couple of things of note. Firstly, of course, the blue people who had the unpacked information, they've got a much wider range on their estimates, which perhaps isn't surprising, but it just shows when you're analysing information, just think about how it's been presented and should you segment it differently. Probably the more interesting thing, though, is it comes back to the example about experts. Look at the industry people. These are 10-year practitioners. Look how narrow their ranges are. The biggest range is the fourth-year undergrads who had training in uncertainty management. And that's the actual answer, by the way. So the only people who came close were the people that had some training. Okay, anchoring. Probably many of you are familiar with this concept. It's very easy to sort of lock on to the first piece of information you hear about a problem. In this case, the question was, what were the world's proved oil reserves in 2003? And that it was the sort of anchor was set by saying to one group, is it greater or less than 574 billion barrels? And the other group, is it greater or less than 1,700 billion barrels? So the question is, what's your best estimate of the world proved oil reserves? And look how people came close to the anchor. So it's another way in which our brain essentially has problems deconvoluting information that's presented to us. Okay, the planning fallacy. We talked about the mega project cost overruns. The Sydney Opera House is a classic. Believe it or not, when the Sydney Opera House was conceived in 1963, it was estimated to cost $7 million. That's what a house on Sydney Harbour costs these days. Anyway, instead of being built in 63, it was built in 73, and a slimmed-down version of the original design cost $107 million. Still seems like a bargain now, but a lot more than the $7 million that was planned. Perth Arena is not quite as dramatic, but that went from about 150 to 500 million and was 2 or 3 years late. So the planning fallacy is alive and well, and it's been around for a long time. I mentioned Kahneman and Tversky, they sort of came up with it. But really, Lindell, who does our marketing, came up with this. This picture, to me, is better than any academic treatise. I mean, this is how people imagine their projects will go. And it doesn't have to be a mega project. I think we can probably all relate to our own little projects where that's what you plan for, and this is what you get. There's pitfalls on the road, there's rain, you have to build bridges. We should be able to cater for those uncertainties when we're doing our planning. This is another one. You could argue, why do you get a Nobel Prize for this? You know, more recent, more readily available, more vivid events are going to stick in our mind, and we are biased by them. Lindell put that picture in because she'd just been on a flight recently and she thought she was going to crash. So this is an important one. Again, we probably are aware of it, but perhaps not aware of the impact. As human beings, we have a tendency to conform. Many of us do. Also, many of us are in organisations. We want to be seen as team players. We want to have a can-do attitude. We want to do the right thing. And that can lead to us acquiescing with the group. So if there's an absence of dissent in any debate, be wary. Now, some very famous experiments on this called the Ash conformity experiments. You can Google them. And essentially, not very good at explaining this, but it's very simple. There were three bars of different heights on a piece of paper, and then a fourth bar off to the side, which was the same height as one of the three. And there were six people in this experiment. Five of them were in on the experiment. The sixth didn't know that it was an experiment. So the first five are all asked which bar was of the three is the same as the one on the left. And they deliberately gave the wrong answer because they were in on the experiment. So, and then the sixth person could see that the first five had got it wrong, but in 38% of occasions, they gave the wrong answer in order to conform with the group. So I'm not making this up. As I say, you can Google it. It's very well documented. So we might like to think we're independent thinkers. Many of us are, but 38% of us are, will basically say black is white in order to conform to the group. And of course, that's a simple example. When you're debating things to which there's no answer, it's very much easier to conform to the group. So, social bias, very important. Right, we've talked about a number of cognitive biases. There's one other bias, a motivational bias. I will just dwell on this a little bit because this is something very common in the industry, but a lot of you might not know this one. But we've talked about that front-end planning stage, the stage leading up to the final investment decision. This is the sort of process that most companies have, a number of stage gates you have to get through to progress the project to the next level where you sort of make more and more investment in the project. Now, typically, at gate one, your estimate should be plus or minus 50%. By gate two, you do more work, refine them to plus or minus 30. By gate three, which is essentially the final investment decision, that's here where you go from planning to executing, plus or minus 10%. Now, that is industry conventional wisdom to this day. But really, for a greenfield project in a new area with new technology, possibly in reservoirs you don't really understand, volatile labour markets, is it realistic? I mean, is it realistic to estimate what a house is going to cost within 10%? Maybe. No, plenty of that haven't come in within. But we're still doing this in the industry today, even though we know it's wrong, or many of us know it's wrong. So there's a motivational bias there. So the criteria creates the wrong behaviours. And I'll give you another example of motivational bias, because I don't think there's anyone from Shell here. It's quite a few years ago now, but Shell actually got themselves in a lot of trouble. Very reputable, very excellent oil company, technically superb. They overbooked the reserves and ran into big trouble with the SEC because everyone was being incentivized. Their bonus depended on increasing reserves. So simple example, the Gorgon project we mentioned, Shell booked reserves to that project, which is before it was approved, which even I know you don't do that. To have reserves, you have to have an approved project. So it happens to the best companies. Right, this is now a subsurface example, just to sort of contrast. Don't worry about the details. This is, shows you all the inputs, basically, to a volumetric calculation. And this is based on our project, its real-life example. These are the sorts of ranges we're coming up with. EUR is ultimate recovery. This is oil and gas in place. This is recoverable. Basically, plus or minus 40%. And we're very comfortable with that as an industry. Yet on the cost side of things, we're telling people to get to within 10%. I know there's a logic for it. You know, you can see what you're building. We're talking about reservoirs, a few Ks under the ground. You've got maybe 3 or 4 wells, each 6 inches in diameter. You know, there's a lot of uncertainty, but there's also a lot of uncertainty at surface. Okay, we talked about the problem. We talked about the reasons for the problem. What are we going to do about it? I certainly haven't got all the answers. I'm going to canvas a few things here. This is called the RISC Conversation Series. Be very interested in your thoughts. First thing is, as I alluded to at the beginning, it's training, it's familiarization, explaining, basically what I'm doing today, explaining how biases and heuristics and psychological effects affect us. So if there's one thing you take out of today, just remember that. I guess people in our industry, we need to identify which biases are most prevalent to the sorts of estimates that we do, most relevant. And demonstrate the impact of those on our estimates. Essentially, it'll be our tendency to narrow the range too much, to have too much confidence. A key point is feedback. I mean, most people in their career in a project company, they might work on 3 or 4 or half a dozen projects. Mega projects, maybe 1 or 2, maybe even 1. We're very fortunate as consultants. We do review literally hundreds of projects, be dozens a year. So we get a lot more feedback than your average person, perhaps in an oil company. One of the reasons why weather forecasting is so good is you get immediate feedback and it enables you to refine your estimate. Of course, when we're talking about large projects, such as we are, you know, it can take 5 years or more. Feedback's a lot slower. Nevertheless, we do get it. We need to calibrate it. I sort of alluded to this at the beginning, the unknown unknowns or the black swan events. Okay, of course, not easy to quantify these, but I think we do need to take them into account. There's plenty of examples of black swan events. I mentioned the flare tower. We're also familiar with a case where a compression module was due to be installed on the platform, and the crane barge that was due to lift the compression module on couldn't actually manage it due to the weather conditions. So it's easy for me to say it and for you to think, well, they should have planned for it, but it didn't happen. So, and finally, be wary of overconfidence and experts. Yeah, often, I mean, all companies do peer reviews, but are they genuinely, at the gates I mentioned in the decision-making process, are they genuinely independent? These so-called experts, they've all had very similar training. They have basically worked for the same types of companies in the same cultures. Are they independent? I would argue not. Maybe you need to get some different people in with different backgrounds. Maybe people with training in psychology or just from different industries. So if you're in a situation like this, and are they going to be subject to peer group pressure? As I said earlier, be wary if there's no dissent, be very wary. And hopefully we'll avoid things like this. Okay, we're getting to, this is actually the final slide, just a final thought here. I guess as engineers and as technical people, we used to hierarchical organisations, we used to Gantt charts, we used to nice sort of linear sequential processes. But projects aren't like that, particularly mega projects. They're about people, they're about relationships, they're about chaotic systems. I would suggest that many of us are not really trained to deal with those systems. And just to introduce a slightly left field comment, politicians, whatever we think of them, they're used to dealing with chaos. You just go into any shopping centre, and those are the people that politicians are having to look after. We in RISC are very fortunate to have Richard Court, former Premier, as our chairman, and he's a fantastic mentor for us. One of the key guys in the industry, petroleum industry peak body in Australia, is Ian McFarlane, former Resources Minister. I'm not plugging politicians particularly, but I'm just saying these people who have had to deal essentially with relationships are actually quite good and may in dealing with the sorts of complexities we face in our industry. And maybe it's people like that that we need running our projects rather than trained technicians. As I say, I don't have all the answers, but I hope I've given you something different to think about. And I hope you'll, whenever you're making estimates from now on, you'll consider some of the ways that our thinking is affected by the way our brains are wired. Thanks for your attention.
Thanks, Simon. I was looking at that slide, that nice linear slide, start and end of the project, and then the other one. That was a very clear indication of the way I put together IKEA furniture. It all starts well, I think it's going to go well, and then so many things coming along the way. Not so good. Guys, thank you, Simon. But folks, we're going to open up for questions for us on the spot, but I'm sure he's happy to take some. There is a microphone here, so is there anyone with any questions that people would like to ask?
I've got members of my team here who can answer the hard ones.
You sort of obviously started pointing out how this is a problem in the oil industry, but it's not. Do you think it's a problem unique or particularly special in the oil industry? I mean, it's the same with defence procurement or building stadiums for sport events or IT projects. It seems to be a universal problem.
No, yeah, absolutely. I only know about one industry, so that's
so, one. So can the oil industry, is it particularly then, obviously it would be advantageous for the oil industry to do something about it, but it's something that the whole society should address.
Really. Yeah, no, very much so. And I tried to allude to, I mean, obviously Kahneman and Tversky, their research is wide-ranging. One of them, Kahneman, was named the 7th most influential economist a year or so ago, even though he's a psychologist by background. All industries can learn from this. It appears the oil industry is not good. I think the construction industry is not good. But I think probably, I suspect marketing people are very good. They know the way our brains work and they play to those. So I think some industries have a lot to learn from others. And as I say, this is not new stuff. This stuff was published in the 70s. We just haven't cottoned onto it yet.
Thank you very much for your presentation. I was struck by the social bias comments you were making, and I'm wondering whether, and I'd like your view on this, how much you think there's just an expectation nowadays for projects to blow out. So there's an attitudinal change that's perhaps required from everybody involved in the project to make it happen, to not blow out, to come in within budget. I don't know what your experience is.
Yeah. No, I think you're onto something here. I think it probably comes down to the motivational bias. I think people, in a lot of cases, people know the uncertainty, but you know, the people who generally get to senior positions in companies, they're not the people who say, oh, I'm not sure. It could be this, it could be that. It's the people who are confident, are forceful, can sell a message. Those are the people that are going to get into these decision-making positions, and everyone is incredibly biased by their project. Everyone wants their project to get up. Essentially, you're in a competition in a big company. You're in competition with other project teams to get your project through. So you are biased. You want your project to proceed. You're not generally thinking of the greater good. You're thinking of your project. So mere motivational and social biases come into it, and I think people are. It's very, very easy. I'm sure I've done it myself. We come under pressure as consultants, where our reports are relied upon for finance, and you have to be pretty. You know, it's not easy to stand up to your client and say no. This is what it is. If they're not going to be able to get finance for their project as a result of your findings, so it's. Not saying it's an easy thing to do.
So I think one of the messages I picked up was maybe looking into the plan better. Is that one of the messages? You're asking about business supply demand in industries, and for technology, space I'm working, quite often the answer is seen as we need to plan better. It's not actually the answer. What we need to do in technology is to break the work up and get some empirical data about actually what's happening. And yes, so break the work up, do small experiments, try and deliver part of the solution early. So I don't know how that would apply in the world. Can you prototype, can you build a plant up at a small scale and grow? I don't know, it's a different world. In technology, you can, and that's where you need fast failure to learn, increase that learning. Mm. The uncertainty is there. Mm. How do you get rid of the uncertainty? You learn fast. Mm. So you learn fast by breaking the work up and getting feedback as soon as possible. You mentioned feedback about estimates and other projects. That definitely would help, you know, but we want to get feedback on real deliver this thing, deliver part of this, get some real failure feedback. Are we delivering the right thing? We've got the right team to build this. I'm equating it to my world. I'm sure some of these principles must apply in the world, just might be a bit harder.
I think you used an absolutely key term there, which I hadn't really come across before, but fast failure. I get generally in the industry, we don't have that. To plan and then drill a well, you're talking at least a year, maybe 2, 3, 4, or 5 years. So we don't get that immediate feedback, and it's very expensive. It can be $100 million to drill one well. And typically, you're going to need several wells before you've adequately appraised a field. So that's perhaps an extreme example, but we don't get that fast failure. It's not to say that you can't do pilot projects. In fact, for some processes, it is pretty standard practice to do a pilot project, but again, you're talking about a lot of money and a long time, even for a so-called pilot. So that's definitely one of the reasons for the problems that we don't get this feedback. We probably don't learn from our mistakes well enough. We always think it's one of the biases. We always think we can do better than the next person, even though we probably can't.
Quite often, the result is probably apart from we need to plan better. That's the conversion. Because you've seen that repeat.
I think, as I say, it's some of it is due to people essentially cooking the books in order to get their projects up.
Sometimes maybe if you came up with a sure estimate, the project never gets
right. Exactly.
Sorry, could you rephrase that? I didn't quite understand.
So
quite a few projects are planned to be delivered what's called top quartile performance.
Yeah, yeah.
Basically, you're asking a group of people to deliver in a 25% success rate.
Right, so unrealistic expectations.
It's consciously unrealistic because if you set the bar at 50%,
yeah.
then you don't put the pressure on to deliver.
Yeah. No, stretch targets, yeah. No, I've worked on projects which have had stretch targets. There's arguments for and against. I mean, the reality is everyone knows it's a stretch target, and most people know what the real target is. But I'm sure most of these projects had stretch targets, but unfortunately, in a lot of cases, that went out the window very, very, very early in the piece. I think there's a role for them, but certainly it's not the solution. Personally, I probably would prefer just open and honest communication. People aren't fools. There's certainly something in trying to align interests. In your contractual arrangements, not having winners and losers. So, if the oil company gains, the contractor gains, rather than having adversarial relationships. That was sort of very fashionable for a while, but then went out the window when everyone was making lots of money in the boom times. So hasn't really answered your question, but it's just a few sort of thoughts around it. Make a very valid point, and really, ultimately, it's the shareholders and it's the taxpayers who pay for this. Even in the case where it's private companies investing their shareholders' funds, if a project goes well over budget, that cost is always is generally under most taxation systems is recovered against tax that's payable. So these projects pay less tax because they've overrun their budget. So, yeah, so you and I, as shareholders and as taxpayers, we end up footing the bill for these projects. And it's not just as simple as simple cost overruns, that the risk of sort of digressing a little bit, but some of the projects that have been alluded to here, they are the pipelines actually cross over each other, going from field A and field B to plant C and plant D. Incredibly inefficient use of resources, because companies like to have their own projects, and therefore there's a lot. I mean, more jobs are being created, more capital has been spent, but at the end of the day, there's going to be less revenue coming back to the government, because all those costs have to be recovered before they start paying tax.
Can I give an example? It's a sport at the same time.
This is my boss, so the answer is yes.
Well, it's a really interesting point, and I'm intrigued by all this and the motivational bias, and I'm really intrigued by the fact that the fourth year students were the only ones that came into the confidence level.
Now, so we've got Simon, we've got Pete, and Martin. These are guys who are going out and they're dealing with clients, and they're consistently being asked, what is the cost, what's the capital cost? We need to get this project into a position where we can finance it. Now, Simon's far too modest. So well, I've gone to clients 6 months after Simon's leaving. And I've spoken with them, and they've said, when Simon first went through, he came up with the capital cost of the project, he was going to kill it. And he was put under pressure by the client to approve it. But he's also put under pressure by the bank. And you think that the banks would be the guys that would be most interested in the right answer being given. But the banks want the project to go ahead because they have the motivation to, you know, put the money. So the motivation of bias has come from all directions. So that I think that over, and 6 months afterwards, this client was so grateful for Simon saying, no, I'm not going to change it. You had to defend it. So I think the loud message is for all of you guys coming through is to really just have the you know, confidence in, and the power of your convictions and we stick to it. And I think that's the hardest thing to do. But I think that's what Simon and Pete and Martin is to be independent and have the strength of your convictions.
But then you're in a management culture which is driving that behaviour. Will you win any business? Will you have a job? So you get wrapped up into that culture very quickly. I mean, you talk about short term, the shareholders, that short term thinking is what drives the management culture and that control of it. They don't respect people and try to get people to improve the process. Tell them what they're making the decisions which aren't always in the best place to make the right decisions that have the best outcome. So this command and control type culture that makes it very difficult to stand up and say, you know,
yeah, keeping it in the mind is very, very difficult.
It is difficult, but you've got to take the longer term view and you'll get respected for it. The same, just constantly behind schedule, over budget, and not delivering. There's no firm at all.
You're creating that life for yourself.
And so, you know, really, when you set your benchmark at the beginning, and then ends to your front end only, I guess, to some extent, you know, sort of set the expectations as well. So you've set the expectation this project is going to go swimmingly, so they said, within 6 months, it's already way off the tracks. And then you're fighting, you're just fighting a rearguard action all the way for the next 5 years.
Quite often, though, like, what I find is that you're articulating at the start the uncertainty of what this plan is. You can't show them, you talk about ranges as the way to talk about the uncertainty. Some people just don't like that uncertainty at the start. They don't want that. They don't want a fixed price, fixed cost, fixed schedule, delivery. Give me the So rather than accept that uncertainty, they'd rather be wrong than uncertain.
Yeah, no, it depends how you explain it. As long as you explain it, there is
So believe me, I can only explain to people, this is the uncertainty, but there's some people who interpret that.
Oh, we get that as well. Yeah, so we get the design, the engineers are saying, well, what's the composition of the gas that you're going to give me? Give me a range. Can't have that. Just tell me what the answer is. You know, and they want one answer. Yeah. So I can engineer it. Well, there isn't one answer. And you have to explain to them how there isn't one answer. There's going to change over time, there's uncertainty, etc. And if you take the time to explain it to them and they appreciate that, okay, now I understand that actually isn't one answer. And so it makes my job a lot harder because I'm going to have to try and manage that. And I've got some variables here when I'm really not responsible on that. Yeah, it does make life harder and you have to work with them. So it's very much, you know, rather than. That's why the integration between the different disciplines is really important. So if you have a silo mentality, sort of like, this is my bit, I pass it on to the next bit, next guy, that's his problem. And then he'll pass it on to the next guy, it's his problem. Then that really is an affair, because then nobody's accepting any uncertainty and issues. And so it's very much, you know, this is our problem. We as a team have to manage it. I'm just doing this bit, it's my area of responsibility, but I'm part of the big team. And that's where the integrated project has to work. So that the guy who's working on creating the steel, calculating the steel volumes, he knows that actually the porosity of the rocks in the ground is actually affects his calculation. Yeah. And he's not responsible for setting up the seal volumes.
So the fourth year university student has some characteristic that makes them better at assessing the risk.
Was it the training
or was it the absence of that
pressure?
The pressure to conform.
Yeah, interesting point. Steve Begg, who was behind that paper, he trained, so he claimed it's the training. But I mean, the third years were equally sort of unbiased, and they didn't get the same ranges. So training definitely has a role to play.
One more question from the young gentleman. I'd like to point out that our RISC colleague will be having a networking session after this, so absolutely these conversations can continue to go on. The young gentleman, what would you like?
I just had a question. You mentioned like weather prediction services and how you're able to see 2 or 3 days later like how accurate you were. How do you deal with that as a process given how long it takes to get feedback at risk? And is that done collaboratively as a group, or is that done like more on a personal basis? And then do you start to have an understanding of your personal biases within that?
Yeah, I can't answer the question about the weather forecasters, other than I have no idea how they do it, but they, as you say, they get constant feedback. I guess for us, we are in quite a privileged position in that, as I alluded to, we see a lot more projects than people working in companies do, who obviously get into a lot more detail than we do. They're working on the project for maybe 3 or 4 years, where our typical assignments are a month, and we work on dozens a year. So, but you do raise an interesting point as to how we disseminate it. I mean, RISC is quite a small organisation. Most of us are on one floor in Perth, which is head office. We've got a couple of other offices. So it's largely informal. I mean, we have databases. Our database Nazi, my colleague Martin, is going to put his hand up. Now, I mean, we do have databases, but a lot of it, I think, be interested in Martin's view, is essentially just talking around the water cooler and talking about projects and informal exchange of ideas. But Martin, what do you reckon?
Yeah, I think going further from what someone said, I think within the industry it's not done. So you are left with this, people who have individual experiences, and they're very unique, and they're very focused on, I did this project for 5 years, this is what went wrong, I won't do that again. So they rely on their personal experiences. Where we are fortunate in our role within RISC and within the industry is that we get to see all these different projects. So for instance, every Australian LNG project, I think if you're at my talk last time around, you would have heard that we've seen every Australian LNG project that is ongoing more than once. We've been into them about 3 or 4 times. So I would say that we're like the weather forecasters of the industry. We get to see all the different projects and all their problems and what they're doing. And we have a fairly unique level of experience because of that. So we don't get to work on a project for 3 or 4 years, but we get to see 21 projects in 3 years. And that gives you a very different view of what is happening within the industry, I think. So, it's then beholden on us to try and spread that view and to spread that information around. And I think that's the part of the reason that we're doing this type of discussion series as well, to try and give that message across that we have a different view of the world to people who do the projects. And I guess Simon and myself and people, we've also done them as well. So we have our personal experiences, which does lead us to having personal biases as well. But on top of that, and I hope that overlaying that and giving us a reason to put our personal biases aside are the influences and the reasons we see across the industry.
Sure.
So I think there's very few organisations that get to do that, so we are very fortunate, and it's beholden on us to then share that with people.
Yeah, that's very true. I think it is your experience. It's like, we went into a fairly major gas project recently, and they showed us their resource range of the gas structure. And without any further information, it was clearly wrong. It was far too narrow. You know, it's just not possible. And when you've looked at, you know, several hundred projects, and you look at this project, you know, you cannot have plus minus 15% uncertainty on your resource range. You know, you haven't even produced a thing. You know, the stage of the project, you know, there's certain goals that have to be achieved to get reduce your uncertainty. One of which is, you know, years of production. You know, having completed the development. And this is in the pre-development stage, and their uncertainty range was just unacceptable. You know, and yes, they had, you know, evidence, calculations, engineering, you know, analysis to support their range that they had. And so then you're starting from a point where, okay, you've got this wealth of years of study, you know, 5 years of study to support this field where the uncertainty range is clearly wrong, but you back it up with, you know, hard facts, and, or what they think are hard facts, and you have to go in there and explain to them that really, you know, it's probably more likely 40%, and it's a very hard thing to do. But you have to have the courage and your convictions to say, you know, we've looked at a lot of projects, I can show you some examples of projects, and these are the uncertainty ranges, so why on earth would yours be here when the average is out here? What's different about your project to all these other projects? And so just gel, soften the minds before you even start. And then you get to the nitty-gritty of how they've done the calculations of each individual component, and try and break those down to support the argument. But again, you had to break down the positioning that they had to start with before you could even attack the problem. And again, that's just experience. I bet you, if you've been somebody who's on the Gorgon project, the next project, when he sees the uncertainty range and the time and cost, I bet you're all
broad.
See if we
can
apply alpha
step to every project that we take.
Yeah.
And might be experiencing your first knowledge. Folks, Simon, thank you very much for coming out on behalf of Curtin. We really appreciate it. I don't know if the audience do. Please, folks, do stay back this evening. We've got some more drinks and paraphrase. We do ask that you take your glasses and bottles out into the foyer and put them on the tables out there, which means me and Katrina don't have to rush around and get them. But otherwise, thanks for coming, everyone. We do appreciate it, and have a wonderful evening. And we look forward to continuing this line of risk going forward as well. So that's great.
Thanks, guys.
I'd just like to thank all the young people in the audience for coming. It's great. I presume you guys are undergrads. It's great to see you here.
You going well?